Yom Kippur is obviously, as we know, the holiest day on the Jewish calendar, and it is marked not only by our atonement, our ability to create or recreate and reestablish that rapport through tshuva, through repentance with God, but it also signifies a day in which we can get closest as possible to the divinity of Hashem, where we can actually reveal spirituality in our physical world. And it's true that we need various acclaments that help us, directives, restrictions that help us achieve that spirituality. Hence, we refrain from eating, we refrain from drinking, we refrain from various activities, and we try and separate ourselves from physical attributes in order for us to accentuate the spiritual ones. And at the end of the day, after immersing ourselves in prayers and thoughts and learning and so on and so forth, we proclaim at the end of the Ne'ilah prayer, the closure of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, we scream, Hashem hu Elohim, God is our Lord. Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. Hashem Yimloch Leolam Va'ed. God is eternal. God is our connection. And we're able to do that because we have immersed ourselves in prayer and thought and reflection and introspect the entire day. One of the things that I do in order to achieve and understand, and I've said this many times, to connect to the spiritual world, it's a little different for me, unfortunately, because of the loss of Gila. And so my connection to God, my connection to spirituality, reveals itself in terms of, or vis-a-vis, my connection to Gila, and how she reveals herself to me, to us, to our family, which we still feel very strongly that she does, from the spiritual world to us here. This Rosh Hashanah, I am in Los Angeles. I'm here because there's a kehilla, there is a particular congregation that I have created a relationship with, and I have been here a number of years. Last year I couldn't come because of Corona, and to be honest, this year they asked me to come, and I wasn't sure if I should, and I decided that I'd come only for Rosh Hashanah. One of the impetuses for me to come was because my daughter-in-law and son, my son and daughter-in-law respectively, they are here in Los Angeles. They went on a tiyul, on a tour in the United States. She had never been to the US, and it happened to be that they would be here for Rosh Hashanah, and we planned that I would meet them in LA and we'd spend Yom Tov together. And that certainly was one of the reasons why I pushed myself to come for Rosh Hashanah, even though in the back of my mind, I consistently asked myself, are you really doing the right thing? Leaving your wife, leaving the rest of your children, your grandchildren, nonetheless combining and being together with two children. But in the back of my mind, there lurked a question of whether or not I was doing the right thing. And on Rosh Hashanah, I joined this kehila, this congregation that I normally do. And it is a rather eclectic group. It's a very odd group of people. And they tend to be individuals, many of them, or some of them don't really have families or connections. There is a sense of unity within the congregation, but not always that emanates from one another or the relationships that exist between one another, but from the whole, the tzibur, the congregation as one, which I guess is a nice thing. But when you put the people as individuals, it's a rather interesting or eclectic group of people. And my daughter-in-law, my son and daughter-in-law, myself, we ate all of our meals in the shul social hall by ourselves. We bought the food ahead of time. People didn't really want to host because of COVID, etc. And when we sat down for each meal, at every single meal, a different straggler came in to join us. We had never invited them, didn't really know them very well, but they came in and they said, can I join you? Is it okay? I'm by myself. I don't really have enough food, or I don't really have someone to talk to. And that was understood. And sure enough, they joined us. And there was happiness, and there was togetherness, and there was a sense of comfort that these people experienced by having been part of a familial atmosphere through my children and myself, that they were able to join us and be a part of a family, part of a unit, part of something, part of a relationship, part of a personal connection that they could then have, even if for the short few moments that they ate with us. And every single meal this happened. And in every single meal, the person who joined us was a little stranger than the one before. And I found myself thinking, when I left the shul on the second day of Rosh Hashanah, I was walking back with my son and daughter-in-law, I turned to them and I said, you know, I can't refrain from thinking, restrain myself from thinking, that all of these people, these eclectic people who were sent to us, so to speak, to join us for the meals, who would not have had anyone to eat with, who would have been by their lonesomes, don't you kind of feel like Gili from above sent them to us? And reminded me that perhaps my purpose for being here for Rosh Hashanah was indeed to be able to have these people join us, to be able to offer these people a sense of home, a sense of warmth, a sensitivity, that they could partake with us for the Chag and feel a sense of what it means to have Chag, Rosh Hashanah, to be a part of a family. And Gila was always the kind of person who embraced everybody. In fact, there are times when I say to myself, when I find myself judging someone or seeing someone for their externals, I have Gila playing over in the back of my head, Abba, don't look at that person that way. Understand that every person has something to bring to the table. Be kind, be sensitive, be understanding, and be accepting. That was Gila. And on this Rosh Hashanah, I felt that her voice, her kol shofar, the sound of the shofar, of her loud, raspy voice, reverberated and sounded clearly to us through the yontif meals that we experienced, through these eclectic characters that joined us during yontif as well. And to tie it all up, on the day in which I was checking out of the hotel, Tzom Gedalia, the day after Rosh Hashanah, the manager of the hotel, who kind of created a rapport with us over the 3 days that we were there in the hotel, and we got a little friendly, he told me finally, before I was leaving, he said, you know, I'm Jewish. I'm married to a Hindu woman, but I still would like to keep some traditions. I know that this week a special day is coming up. What's it called again? I said, it's Yom Kippur. He said, yes, yes, Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. Can you tell me which day it is? And I reminded him, and he said, I think I'm supposed to fast on that day. I said, yeah, many Jews do. He said, thanks for telling me which day it is, because that's what I'm going to do. This is what it means to reveal God's divinity in this world. This is the feeling that we have when we wrap ourselves within the spiritual divinity of the day of Yom Kippurim. And these are the conclusions that we're supposed to come to on this holy day. I hope and pray that, as I've explained many times, the word Gila means legalot, to reveal Yah, to reveal God's divinity in this world. This time of Aseret Yemei Tshuva, may we continue to reveal God's divinity in this world, in our world, in whatever way we see fit, and in whatever way it's sent to us. Because if we look hard enough, we'll find it. That is indeed the Tshuva way. That is indeed the Torah way. And that is the Gila way. Gemar Chatima Tova. We should only have a good and prosperous and an easy year for all of Am Yisrael. Thank you once again for joining us. Please remember to consider subscribing to the page below and send me your comments. I will get back to you. Have a great day.